your Bible open, please. Mark's Gospel, chapter 16, and I want us to begin reading at verse number 9. Now, when Jesus was risen early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast 7 devils. And she went and told them that had been with him as they mourned and wept. And they, when they heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. Now remember, in the background of all this, Jesus had told his disciples how many times that he would go into Jerusalem and suffer at the hands of the Gentiles and be crucified and rise again the third day. But when the actual news came, Christ is alive, the disciples, those who had been with him, believed not. And after that, he appeared in another form unto 2 of them as they walked and went into the country. And when they went and told it unto the residue, neither believed they them. Afterward, he appeared unto 11 as they sat at meat and upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. Now, you don't have to turn, but listen carefully to this passage of Scripture in the book of John, chapter number 20, and verse number 26. And after 8 days, again his disciples were within, and Thomas was with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, "Peace be unto you." The Lord Jesus appeared to his disciples 10 times after his resurrection. And 12 times, if you count, when he appeared to Saul of Tarsus on the road to Damascus, and of course John on the Isle of Patmos. But 10 times, Jesus came to where his disciples were and appeared unto them. Now, I want to talk to you with this little thought in mind this morning. When Jesus comes to us, seems like always the Lord Jesus went unto his disciples in the hour when they needed him most. They were in the midst of the sea and they were afraid for their lives. And in the fourth watch of the night, the Lord Jesus goes walking unto them on the water. Every time the disciples had a situation where they knew not what to do, I'm glad that Jesus came to where they were and helped them. When Jesus comes to us, does he appear to us today? Does the Lord Jesus appear to us today? If so, how does he show himself? And why does he come to us? Why is it that God would be interested in us and our situation? I'm glad that God does care, aren't you? In your darkest times, your hardest parts of life, you'll find that Jesus will come to where you are. I'm glad that I know that. Notice this, if you will, and I just want to make a few little points here. And notice in verse number 12 of our text, though he came to them, that it was reported that he was alive and been seen of her, they didn't believe that. And after that, he appeared, notice this, in another form unto them. Now, I'm not sure that I understand all that that is talking about, but he appeared in another form unto them. I do know that Scripture is found in Luke 24 and verse number 16. The disciples, of course, were discouraged and disheartened because Christ had been crucified and buried and they had seen it. And on this particular Sunday afternoon, they were walking to Emmaus, some 3/4 to a mile outside of Jerusalem. They were going along there heavy-hearted. And a stranger joined their company. And he began to talk with them. And the Bible said he explained all things that was written of him in the Bible. And it caused their hearts to burn within them. They didn't know at that time, didn't recognize him as the Lord Jesus Christ. Another form he appeared unto them. Seemed like their eyes were holding and they just could not recognize him. I think that after the resurrection, our Lord took upon him a form that can only be recognized when he reveals himself unto us.
I think the Jesus that people now talk about, they cannot know him, and they do not know him unless they're introduced to him by the Holy Spirit of God. If you know who Jesus is, it is because that God has revealed who he is unto you. And we don't know him after the flesh anymore. We know him as the Holy Spirit of God reveals him unto us. And so he appeared to them in another form as they walked on the Emmaus Road. And I've often found that verse very interesting. And you know what? I think this. I think that the Lord Jesus often comes to us. Now, don't think I've gone off the rocker this morning. I know that physically he rose from the dead, and I know that physically he is seated in a physical glorified body at God's right hand. But I want to tell you, he does come to us today. The songwriter said, standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll see the Lord Jesus. And of course, he's made known to us by the presence of the Holy Spirit that's in the world, and more importantly, lives in us as believers. But I'm glad that every once in a while we can see the Lord Jesus. I've thought about in the last several weeks, you know what? I think there's a lot of things that God does for us that we don't even stop and recognize that God's doing for us. I think there's blessings that come to us on a daily basis that oftentimes we just don't recognize and just don't think about. I remember several years ago, I was preaching up north in a missions conference, and me and another pastor had gone up there, and I was driving a pretty new car at the time. But as we went out of Kokomo, Indiana, I noticed that, the check engine light had come on before. And I'd learned to just overlook that. But this time, the battery light come on. And it was a brand new light. It came on as we were going out of the city limits of Kokomo, Indiana, headed north. And so I looked at that and I said to that preacher, I said, uh-oh, something's going on. I said, the battery light's on. He said, well, check engine light's been on all this trip. And he said, don't pay it any attention. It's going to be all right. But I had a bad feeling about it. I thought, no, this is something new. And I'm thinking to myself, well, the alternator's going out and the battery is losing its charge. And guess what? I was right about that. So anyhow, we started on up the road. And when you get north of Kokomo, Indiana, that land is as flat as a tabletop. And there's nothing around. Some of you folks is traveling that direction. You know exactly what I'm talking about. And so here I go. And the lights, it's just getting dusky dark. And my lights started going out. And I noticed the panel lights were getting dim. And I said, oh, Lord, I said, this thing's going to strand us out here in the middle of nowhere. I said, turn that radio off. And I turned the lights off. And was in the middle of nowhere. So you know what I done? I just sped up. And I don't know how fast that old car would go, but I maxed it out as fast as that thing. Well over 100 miles an hour, I got that old car up through. I thought, well, maybe we can coast in the next town. Sure enough, I got it up to maximum speed, and the thing just went dead. Everything just went black. And the motor shut off. And so here I am on this flat land. And that thing went for about 2 or 3 miles. And the only thing that we had seen, there was one little tiny crossroads that crossed that highway. And so when it went as far as it would roll, I pulled over right in that crossroads. And I looked around, and there was one house. I told that preacher, I said, well, I guess God wants me to go to that house. No cell phones back in the day. So I go up to that house and had a big old fence around it. And inside they had some of them old Rottweiler dogs. And boy, them things act like they're going to eat me alive. And so I just stood outside and there's a carrying on. So finally this fellow opened the door and come out. And I'm going to tell you something. He looked like he'd crawled out from under a rock. He had the longest, stringiest hair, had a big old beard. He had more tattoos on him than a tattoo shop has. They'd tried them all out on him. And he had brass and he had earrings sticking out of everywhere. I never seen such a feller. I said, oh, Lord, I'd rather face the dogs than to face him. I said to him, I said, sir, I hate to bother you. I said, but my car's quit. And I said, I think the alternator's out and the battery's run down. He said, I'll get some jumper cables. And he said, I'll give you a jump. He said, you'd be surprised at how many cars stop right there in that place. And I can imagine. So anyway, I got talking to him. He's a nice fella. And I went out and he jumped my car off. And he said, let's leave the cables on for just a little bit. He said, that'll put a little juice in your battery. I thought, good deal. I'm in favor of that. So there was my opportunity. I said, sir, I don't know why the alternator quit. And I don't know why it quit here. I said, we've been traveling over 500 miles today. And I said, I don't know why yours is the only house here. But I said, I want to ask you something. Are you a church-going man? I said, do you know the Lord Jesus as your personal Savior? You know what that big old rough man did? He bowed his head like that, and the tears started running down his face. He said, are you a preacher? I said, I am. He said, well, I want to tell you my story. And he told me how that he was saved as a younger man. But something had happened. I don't know what. You know, there's all kind of things that happen to us in life. Life happens to us. But he'd gotten discouraged, and he'd gotten out of church. He said, I was thinking just today that God must not be pleased with me. And he said, I know what it's like, preacher, to be in church and feel the presence of the Lord. He said, I know what it's like to be able to get on my knees and feel like that my prayers reach heaven. But he said, that's all gone. And I said, well, sir, I want to tell you something. I said, you can get right with the Lord right here and right now. And I had prayer with that fellow right on the side of that road. I don't remember what road it was, 31 or something, 35, something goes north out of Kokomo, Indiana. And out there in the middle of nowhere, I bowed to that man and prayed. I got back in the car, and I was thankful for that. Me and that preacher talked about that. I believe there's a purpose and a reason for things that happen to us in life. I hate that my battery went dead. I hate that my alternator went out, and I didn't get it fixed until the next day, and I missed my preaching appointment in the northern part of Indiana. But I believe that God sent me all that way so I could talk to that man that lived in that house on the corner of that road out in the middle of nowhere. And you know, when you look at it like that, aren't you glad for the providence of God in your life? You see, God does appear to us. And I think there's certain things that can only be explained by the fact that God is with us and leading us. And when we desire to be led by the Spirit of God, I think we can see a lot of blessings that oftentimes we overlook. I believe Jesus just as real in that part of Indiana as he is right here this morning. And on your job or wherever you may be, those things that we often think are disappointing to us, I thank God. If that's God coming into our life and making the everyday and the usual and the mundane, it makes life a special place when Jesus comes in the midst of it. Oh, how important that is. When Jesus comes to us, he does oftentimes, and we don't recognize it. Sometimes we're too busy complaining to see the good blessings that God allows us to have. He came to his disciples, and we'll talk about that for just a little bit. And I want you to notice five things, and I'll be very quick with what I say this morning. Why did Jesus come to them? First of all, I think, to revive their faith. Notice here repeatedly in our text, no less than three times, verse 11, verse 13, and verse number 14, it says that they did not believe, that they believe not, over and over. He had told them that he would rise from the dead, but they had stood by the cross and they looked as our Lord was crucified and his lifeless body took down and put beneath the ground, and the stone rolled on the mouth of the cave. Now listen, they had had a long history of that. We know that when people die, they don't rise from the dead. Even though Jesus told them that he was, I think their faith was somewhat lacking. All the way up till he was crucified, they thought he was going to set up a kingdom, and they were so disappointed, and it rattled their faith. Sometimes things will happen in life that can rattle our faith. Sometimes we need Jesus to come back to us and revive and encourage our faith. I'm glad that he does that. That's important to him. It's important to us. And I would remind you of this fact, that here they were disbelieving the resurrection. You know, in Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, when we lead somebody to faith in Christ, you know what the Bible says that we have to believe? It says, if we shall confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that God hath raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. You say, why is it important to believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ? Well, the resurrection was the one thing that validated and proved that he was the Son of God. I want to say something very respectfully this morning and very reverently, because I feel like I am standing on holy ground. All that Jesus taught and all that he did, All the good that he done in all of his ministry would have been null and void had he not raised from the dead on the third day. That was the thing that proved that he was the Son of God. To be saved, you have to believe that Jesus is more than a historical figure. You have to believe that Jesus is more than just a good man. You have to believe that he is the Son of God, that he rose from the dead. And if he had not arisen from the dead, and here's the part that I don't be careful with, Jesus Christ would have went down in history as the biggest hypocrite, the biggest liar, the biggest, what would you call him, shyster, the biggest crook that ever walked on the face of God's earth. But I want to say this, when he arose on that third morning, it validated everything he'd ever said and that he ever did. No, listen, their faith in who he was needed to be revived at that particular time. There's times that you'll go through in your life that you'll need Jesus to come to where you are. Now, remember this, they couldn't go to where he was. He came to them. It's always that way. God always comes to us in our situation. You ever gone through periods of time in your life where it felt like God was a million miles away? You start looking inside and you say, Lord, I know I've trusted you and I believed in you, but why is it, God, that you feel so far away from me at this particular time? Every once in a while, he'll come by and start tugging on your heartstrings to revive your faith. And it confirmed to them that he was the Son of God, and their faith was not misplaced in him. Secondly, Jesus came to them to reassure their forgiveness. Here in Mark 16 and verse number 6, notice what the Bible says. The angel who was at the tomb of Jesus said to those who came early to the sepulchre that morning, he saith, be not affrighted. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen, and he is not here. Behold, the place where they laid him. I like verse 7. But go your way and tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee. You ever felt like that your forgiveness needs a little bit of reassurance? I have. You see, all of them had deserted him, walked away from him. He went to the cross alone. A few women went and stood by the foot of this cross. But all the disciples had scattered and gone away from him. They all felt like a bunch of cowards and traitors. Peter denied him and even cursed and said, I do not know him. Can you imagine how Peter, of all of them, must have felt? But they've been thinking about it 3 days, and he that they loved was taken from them. They couldn't say anything to him. They couldn't go to him. But he comes to them and he gives them the word. You go tell my disciples, the angel did, that I go before them into Galilee. Reassure that they are forgiven. Do you realize that if Jesus Christ had not been raised from the dead, we couldn't experience the forgiveness of God? Oh, how important that is. 3 days to think about it. The more sins pile up and they seemed further from God than they ever had. Been with them all that time, and look how they acted. Look how they done the Lord Jesus. Now they're living with that guilt on their conscience. And then it was that Jesus come to him. I want to ask you, have you done something that's wrong, bad, feel guilty and at a distance from God? I want to tell you something. He'll come to where you are. He'll confront that sin in your life. But I want to tell you what he'll do. He'll forgive you of that sin. That thing that separates you from God, he's willing to forgive you of that. I think that's why a lot of people stay away from the church. They're afraid to come. They're afraid that he'll have to deal with their sin. They may be afraid that God cannot or will not forgive them. But he came to his disciples to reassure their forgiveness. And then thirdly, to renew their fellowship in John chapter 20 and verse 19 and 20. Listen to these words. Same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. Came Jesus and stood in the midst of them and said, "Peace be unto you." And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his sides. And then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. They went from sadness to gladness because of this fact that now their fellowship with him had been renewed. Oh, I'm glad that we can have our fellowship with holy God renewed. Oh, listen, fellowship can be broken. There'll be a loss of peace in your heart. There'll be a loss of purpose if you get out of fellowship with God. You may forget what your purpose and reason for being in this world is. And then, of course, there'll be a loss of progress. You won't grow spiritually if you don't get back in fellowship with God. You know, I thought about this. A renewed fellowship is precious, isn't it? It's sweeter. Sometimes we take it for granted. But if you ever have that fellowship broken and then all of a sudden you get it back and you get restored to that place where you need to be, oh, how precious and how sweet that is. And at that time, the Bible even says here that Jesus breathed on them and said, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost." He empowered them now to go out and do what they should have been doing all along. How blessed that is. Old devil will tell you if you get out of church, if you have your fellowship with God broken, old devil will come sit on your shoulder and this is what he'll say to you. He'll say, "Boy, you've done it now. You've made a fool out of yourself. And God, he don't want to have anything to do with you. He's done with you. You can never get right with God. You can never get back where you once were with God. But I want to say that he is a liar and the father of it." You can have that fellowship with God restored and renewed. And that is exactly what you need. He'll fill you with his spirit. I think one of the worst things about being out of church is, and getting out of God's will, is you lose touch with that spirit that we have sensed in this place today. Boy, that's a blessing, isn't it, to feel and sense the presence of God. And when you let stuff pile up in your life, it gets between you and you don't, I don't know, there's just something joyous about it. There's just something about feeling and being in the presence of God that makes everything good. Matter of fact, that's what makes church. Is the presence of God. It's not hearing the choir. It's not hearing me preach. It's not the Sunday school hour. But just getting in the presence of an almighty God and realizing that he loves you and everything's all right between you and God. Hallelujah to God. I want to tell you, that's a wonderful thing to experience. But you let stuff get in your life and it blocks all that out, a renewed fellowship. I'll never forget years ago, our youth choir used to go with Dr. Ralph Sexton Jr. And he preached all over the countries. And he was in this particular church in a revival meeting. And he had been there preaching Monday through Thursday. And not much had happened. But on Thursday night, it just so happened that our youth choir was there. And we sang in that church. And it was packed from front to back. That church was packed. But boy, that night just seemed like the heavens opened up and the glory of God descended. And he gave the invitation, and when he did, people come by the scores to get right with God, to renew their fellowship with God, and had people saved in that service. And I hadn't been in church all that long myself, and I was just sitting there in amazement watching all of that. And I remember this one lady that came down. She came down to the altar, and she prayed a little bit, and she got up and went back to her seat. In a few minutes, she came back, and this time, she just broke all to pieces. And I remember her getting down in that altar, and you talking about doing some praying. I couldn't hear all that she said, but I do remember when she stood up, she throwed her hands up in the air, and she shouted like a Comanche Indian. And I don't remember all she said, but I do know this. She said, hallelujah to God. She said, I hadn't felt this clean since I got saved. Amen. Pretty good place to get, isn't it? Renewed fellowship. He came to relieve their fears. Notice in John chapter, well, you don't turn there, but John chapter 20, verse 19, verse 21, verse 26, he said, be not afraid, be not afraid, do not fear. Somebody said that do not fear is found 365 times in the Bible. Don't be afraid. We're living in a world this morning where there's fear and there seems to be no peace. You say, where in the world are we going to find peace? Well, I want to tell you one place that I know. I want to tell you one little place that I know where there's true peace this morning. And it's down on the inside of my heart. Not because I'm a good fellow. No, it ain't. But I want to tell you, I bowed as a six-year-old boy. And I made peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. In my heart, there's a peace. The world didn't give me this peace. But he gave it to me when I got saved. I wouldn't trade that for nothing in the world. I wouldn't trade that with anybody. Relieve their fears, and oftentimes there's many of them. We don't know what's going to happen next. Sometimes it seems like we're going through life waiting on the other shoe to drop. But I want to say this, don't be afraid, because in your fear the Lord Jesus will come to you. And then finally, to reveal their future in John chapter number 20 and verse number 21, listen to what Jesus said to those disciples that he had appeared to, strengthened them, helped them, encouraged them, forgave them. He said unto them, peace be unto you, as my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. He came to reveal to the disciples about their future. I bet Peter thought, my preaching ministry's over, after he denied the Lord. I bet all of them did. Matter of fact, Peter, so discouraged, he said, I'm going to go fishing. And a whole bunch of them went with him. They said, well, if you're going back to fishing, we are too. They said, we're going to go back and take our old jobs back. We're going to reunite with our families. And we're going to forget this following Jesus stuff. And we're going to go back to things like they were before. But I want to tell you, here when he came to them, he revealed their future to them. As my Father sent me, it's going to be like this in your life. And these common, discouraged fishermen turned around, went to Jerusalem, stayed in the upper room till the day of Pentecost. And the one seemed like that had sinned the worst was Peter. You know what he did? He got full of the Holy Ghost on Pentecost. And this man went out and he preached, and 3,000 people got saved in one sermon. The rest of them went out. They went around the world. It's an interesting story. The lives of the apostles, these very men that were discouraged and had quit, he said, I'm going to send you everywhere. And they went everywhere. Some went into Asia, some went into India, some went into Europe, and they went all across the regions. And they literally, every one of them, died a martyr's death with the exception of John the Apostle. What was it that these men were willing to not only give their fortunes and their futures, what were they willing to give their life for? It was so that they could preach the gospel, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They saw him alive after he arose from the dead. Wouldn't they have been the worst fools ever to have given their life to something that was a myth or something that was a hoax, something that was not really true? No, these men believe it to the point that they gave their entire futures for what they saw in the Lord Jesus when he came to them. Now, I'll tell you something. This is a little bit personal. But all of us get off track at some time. But I'm glad that I've seen enough in my Christian life that I can't get over what God did for me. Changed my life totally and completely. Stand our feet, please.
Troublesome times are here.
Feeling men
charged with fear.
Freedom we all hold dear.
Now is that strength.
Humble your heart. Jesus is coming soon.
Morning or night or noon.
Many will meet their doom.
Trumpets will
surely sound.
All of the
dead shall rise.
The righteous men
in the skies.
Going where
so many
cold,
losing their
home of gold.
This and God's
word is told. Evils abound.
When these signs
come to pass,
nearing the
end that lasts,
it will come
very fast.
Trumpets will sound.
Is coming soon,
morning or night
or noon.
Many will
meet their doom.
Trumpets will
surely sound.
All of the
dead shall rise.
Righteous men
in the skies,
knowing where
troubles will soon
be o'er.
Happy
forevermore.
When we meet on
that shore, free from all care.
Rising up
in the sky,
telling this
world goodbye.
Onward we
then will fly.
Rabbits will surely sound.
All of the dead shall